My name is Victoria Judson. I'm Associate Chief Counsel, Tax Exempt and Government Entities. And with me from the IRS, I'm pleased to have Linda Marshall, Senior Counsel, Qualified Plans Branch 1, Office of the Associate Chief Counsel, Tax Exempt and Government Entities. And Chan McGee, Actuary, Rulings and Agreements, Employee Plans Division, Tax Exempt Government Entities. And from the Department of the Treasury, Harlan Weller, Government Actuary, Office of the Assistant Secretary, Tax Policy. We have three people scheduled to speak today. Lynn Dudley from American Benefits Council, Michael Pollack from Willis Towers Watson, and Bruce Cavanhead from ERIC, the ERISA Industry Committee. Is there anyone else in the audience who isn't listed who would like to speak today?
I'm not exactly listed, but Lynn's not here. I'm going to do it for Lynn.
Okay, so okay, may I say we'll replace Lynn. Okay. And as many of you probably know, our rules are that each speaker has 10 minutes. We have this wonderful light system, and it'll start green. When you have 3 minutes left, it will turn to yellow, and then it turns to red. Should any of the panelists have questions while you're speaking, we can pause it. And then often after you're finished with your comments, there'll be additional questions that don't count against the time. And with that, I call our first speaker, Pat Mason from American Benefits Council.
Thank you very much. As you mentioned, my name is Ken Mason. I'm a partner at the law firm of Davis and Harmon. I'm here today for the American Benefits Council. Thank you for holding this hearing and for the opportunity to testify. As proposed, the mortality regulations would have a significantly adverse effect on employers sponsoring defined benefit plans, diverting billions of dollars away from jobs and job-producing activities to the pension plan. In this context, we believe, I think the critical thing is that this regulation be subject to the cost-benefit analyses and rules set down in applicable executive orders 12866 and 13771. Now, these orders only apply to regulations that are a, quote, significant regulatory action and are legislative rules as opposed to interpretive rules. And as I'm going to discuss, we strongly believe that this regulation falls in both categories.
In relevant part, a significant regulatory action is an action that is expected to have an effect on the economy of $100 million or more annually. This regulation.
Can I stop and just ask, what is the baseline you're using under your theory? I mean, doesn't the statute require us to modify the tables to reflect changes based on reasonable assumptions? So isn't that statutorily prescribed? So it's so it's regulatory, not legislative?
I think that there are two answers to that. One answer is that the executive orders are completely clear that they apply regardless of whether a regulation is statutorily required. They're explicit on that point. So that even if So in other words, but there's a second point answer part to answer to your question. But the first part is, whether this is statutorily required or not, these executive orders still require the application of the of the cost benefit analyses, including the 2-for-1, the 13-7-71, and they are explicit on that point.
But what I mean,
but
assuming
I understand you have a baseline question.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not necessarily saying we would agree with that view, but assuming we did,
I mean, it's explicit.
Well,
it's,
what would be your baseline? Because you seem to be saying you're talking about billions of dollars,
we are going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about that, and the answer there is that the baseline, and essentially, if this were sort of an interpretive regulation where you simply followed a statute, then I think the argument from the government, from the Treasury, has always been that the results of the regulation flow from the statute and not from the regulation. And that is, in most tax regulations, that's absolutely right. And here, that's clearly not the case.
But why not? I mean, the statute says we're supposed to prescribe mortality tables using reasonable assumptions. So why isn't that prescribed by the statute?
Well, because there's nothing in the statute that says that this particular version. In other words, you have legislative authority. And to say, okay, we can actually, so there's the argument you're making would sort of argue that you could do anything. You could sort of have people living to 150, and that would have
no effect. It says
review requirement in the statute.
There's 10-year review, and we need reasonable assumptions. So under your theory, if after 50 years the actual mortality based on actual experience changed from living to 65 years to 85 years, we couldn't do that. Wouldn't that be prescribed by the statute?
No, that's absolutely not right. Absolutely not right. It is. Because the law, the executive orders are clear. You are required to do this. In other words, we're not arguing that you aren't supposed to do this. We are simply saying that by clear black letter law in the executive orders, that you are, regardless of whether this is statutorily required, that's specifically addressed, you are required to go through the economic analysis. And that is spelled out. And sort of repeatedly in the guidance. So the fact that you are required does not affect the application of these executive orders. And in terms of the baseline, you really can't say there's a particular baseline because you are given vast, vast discretion. And so to argue that
but it's supposed to be based on actual experience. But
I mean,
let's go back.
It's
so
not
you're
even
also
based
saying
on
it's
actual
two
experience.
For one.
It's
so
not.
You're saying when Congress tells us we have to issue a rule, we also have to remove two.
I didn't issue these executive orders. That's what they say. That's exactly
okay, so
what they say.
Okay, so what do you think the baseline is? Because it sounds like you're saying the baseline would be whatever the prior table was. Is that your position?
I think the baseline is that you have great discretion. In other words, for example, you're sort of saying, based on prior experience, you have a 1% projection assumption. That's not based on anything. That's based on 12 people in a room making up.
Right, but there are a lot of other assumptions, too. So what I'm trying to ask you, when you do the billion, what is your baseline going to be? Is it going to be what the results would be under the old tables? Or are you saying you should distinguish between certain assumptions that are more the estimates and others that are based on historical data? I'm just asking, what is your position on that baseline?
I think our position would be that on the baseline, there is no identifiable baseline. In other words, because the reg, nothing happens without this reg. In other words, that's...
So you're saying any change, you know, from 50 years ago, everything would have to count.
It's not 50.
But
not
for 10, for the last 10, you're saying everything would have to
really
count. Since 2008, everything would count.
No, 2000, because we used RP 2000 for the last table.
Okay, right, so all historic changes from 2000 to 2013, you would count.
I didn't write
the
these executive orders, but the executive orders are 100% clear.
Well, I'm sorry I led you off your comments,
but
this
fun.
Has been very
it
helpful. You now may please continue.
Okay. You know, and somehow we sort of have woven in some of the things we're going to talk about. But, I mean, the question is this an interpretive reg or a legislative reg? And the law is clear that it is a legislative reg if you could not enforce this without the regulation. In other words, could you enforce a new mortality table based on the statute? The answer is obviously no. That's the legal test. So this is a legislative reg.
And where do you get that legal test from?
D.C. Circuit.
Okay, what case?
And I will send you the case.
Okay, thank you.
So that is sort of the distinction, is could you enforce the statute? And here there's nothing to enforce. And so the second question is, you know, and again, this gets back to one of the things you were saying, is there discretion, you know, or do you simply say, well, there's one study out there, we had to follow it, and that's simply inconsistent with the statute. The statute asks you to look for experience tables. Not only do you publish experience tables, but you also published projection improvement rates, which is pure speculation. I mean, people just have opinions. There's no experience that tells us what's going to happen in the future. It is pure speculation. And so to say that this is sort of dictated by the statute and that you didn't have discretion, there's no there. And even if with respect to the actual base tables, they don't say pick that table and follow it 100%. They simply say take into account available studies. And to sort of just say, okay, well, that means we have to follow the one thing that we normally follow, that's not what the statute says. You have tremendous discretion on the projection. You also have tremendous discretion on sort of how, whether to take that SOA table sort of in a whole or to adjust it and modify it in conformance with some concerns that were articulated with respect to that table.
But so looking at the statute, just so I understand what you're saying on the baseline, it says that we're supposed to, the table shall be based on the actual experience of pension plans and projected trends in such experience. But
no,
you're
saying take into account. Let's read the whole thing. It says take into account. It
right.
did not say follow. It says take into account.
No, I understand that. So are you taking the position that as we take that into account, it all would be above the baseline, even if it's based on historical data?
Well, I think the question is on the baseline, and it is, and I would sort of invite you to sort of look through the executive orders on this point. But they're the only baseline. In other words, there is no one way you can identify that says here's how the table should be improved and or sort of should be modified. And to include the 1% projection, there's no basis for that to sort of say, well, that's the right answer. So I find it very, very hard to say, okay, we pick this, and so therefore
but
that becomes the baseline.
Every time I ask you, you move to the one projected thing. What about the historic data?
Okay. Well, it's more fun to talk about projected.
I understand why it's stronger for the
point you're trying to make, but I'm trying to ask about the historical data piece.
Yes, and I think there you have tremendous discretion to, quote, take into account available studies. And so to me, and there was a lot of criticism of that study. And so the argument that despite the fact that a lot of people expressed a lot of reservations about the study, that by definition becomes your baseline, I don't see how you get there.
But partly
in other words,
my
that's a legal conclusion that becomes the baseline with no support. That would be bypassing the notice and comment process by saying, here's our baseline. We're not going to sort of consult with any stakeholders on what the new baseline is. We are simply going to establish this and say that by definition has to be the new baseline without input.
So you're saying we need notice and comment about the baseline? Because it also seems that under your argument, there would never be any regs that are not legislative regs.
That's
because you're always modifying.
That's not true at all. That's not true at all. In other words, take any of the sort of regular codes sections. You can enforce those based on the statute, 401A9, 401A4. You can enforce those based on the statute. This, you cannot. And that's a huge night and day difference under the law as to why one is legislative and one is interpretive.
So you're saying that every point in the 401A9 regs we could have enforced without publishing those regs?
I think you have the discretion. You would have had the discretion, and this has happened in countless situations, you know, because there are a lot of situations where there's a general statute, and your enforcement approaches are much more refined than the general statute. So in other words, would you come to every single conclusion in the A9 regs? Well, obviously that's unrealistic, but in many, many cases throughout the code, you enforce the statute in a nuanced way that is not sort of reflected directly in the code. And that's the way the process works. I mean, there are thousands of examples of that. So the question here is, can you enforce it under this code generally? And generally the answer is yes with respect to almost all tax regs. Here, it's literally impossible. You cannot enforce it without the reg.
So you think it doesn't matter that it prescribes that we're supposed to do it, look at actual experience and projected trends. You think in those cases, in all cases, you'll have a zero baseline and...
I don't see a mechanism that's respectful of the notice and comment process that could give you a different baseline.
We had notice and comment.
Yes,
you're
but
here
now
commenting.
You're saying to me that without sort of forget about notice and comment, the baseline is this new table over here that's never been subject to notice and comment. In other words, it's never been approved. How in the world?
But Andrew, you're saying each time you'd have to infinitely have other things. You're saying after you approve it, then you have an additional notice and comment on what you already approved?
No, I'm just saying you can't assume that the proposal is right in establishing the baseline. You can't. That would be invalidating notice and comment.
And so, therefore, the baseline is this base table we're using has a base year of 1996.
So
your view is the baseline is 1996. Okay. All right.
It is the 2008 regulation.
That has tables
based on a base table with a midpoint of 1996.
2000 was my understanding.
Well, it was RP 2000.
Right.
The report
was
in 2000.
You're right. So,
okay.
Right.
So we understand. So your position was we have a 1996 data-based baseline.
I didn't write the law.
Okay.
You know, I think you're the one sort of taking sort of this way and sort of saying, we're going to, without notice and comment, establish a new baseline and impose that baseline without regard to input.
I will say, with all due respect, without notice and comment, we are here at a public hearing.
You're actually telling me that I have to use your proposal as my baseline. That's sort of saying the notice and comment is irrelevant. So I'm saying, no, you cannot assume that what you've proposed is the baseline, which is really what you're saying. You're saying the proposal is the baseline.
Well, no, I think we have a different point of view of whether this is legislative, regulatory, or law, or whether it applies. But this has been very helpful that you clarified this position. And
take a turn for a moment.
You get
here.
A turn?
Yes, I get a turn. I've been sitting here quietly. So, separating out for the moment the issue of the base table from the mortality improvement scale, I understand that you have a comment that the long-term assumed rate of improvement that we have used for the 2018 tables, by the way, we don't necessarily commit to using what the Society of Actuaries has issued along each year, that 1% that the Society of Actuaries used in late 2016, which we propose to apply for 2018, is too high. And you say you're suggesting that it imposes additional cost on plan sponsors. And I think if we just focus on that question, I think Vicky is asking cost by reference to what? I know that there's been a suggestion in the comments that the Social Security actuaries use 0.75%. So if the argument is the cost is the effect of that 0.25 faster percent per year, what makes the 0.75%.
That is not my position.
So is your position the cost is relative to no improvement?
It's relative to the current tables.
He's saying the cost is relevant to the 2008 table based on 1996 data. That's what he's saying.
But
could you tell us what you would project the marginal increase in the amount increase in cost due to using a 1% mortality improvement versus 0.75?
No, I could not. I mean, I couldn't ask my more learned colleagues, you know, two of whom you're going to be speaking to soon, but I, off the top of my head, I could not tell
it,
you.
It might be interesting to have that information.
It would be interesting.
As an actuary, usually the requirement is we measure the liability on reasonable assumptions. So when you say we have, or IRS and Treasury has complete discretion or tremendous discretion in choosing a mortality table and projection scale, I wonder, do you feel that it can be anything?
No, absolutely not. But I mean, the range of reasonable assumptions, it's not like we wouldn't be having this meeting if there was one set of reasonable assumptions.
Right. So can you explain, I mean, elaborate on the range of assumptions in mind?
You know, I think the question is, I guess the short answer is no, okay? I would need to, and I'd be happy to follow up on this, but, you know, if your question is, what other sort of regulatory approaches on the whole, on the base table, as well as on the projection rate, what's the range of reasonableness with respect to that? I mean, that's beyond my capacity here today.
And
I would say that is going to be a measure and of, well, I guess my sort of reaction is there is sufficient leeway in your sort of in the reasonableness, which is a broad concept, to sort of get to the point that this has a huge effect on defined benefit plan sponsors.
Yeah, but I think what would be interesting is to hear what the difference would be between that range of reasonableness as opposed to compared to a table based on 1996 data.
And are there other, you know, broad-based studies of pension plan participants that you think we should have used, say, instead of RP 2014?
That's, in some ways, I've heard that sort of argument. Well, gee, this was the only table we had. If that's your standard, okay, and so we have to follow it 100% because it's the only table we have. Well, for the rest of time, that's always going to be true. Because this process, no one else has the time and resources to produce this table. No one. So, but that is not the, so the fact that only one entity produces a comprehensive table doesn't mean you can't, the statute certainly doesn't say it, and nothing in the law would suggest you kind of say, okay, one entity produced this. There was controversy about what they did. Rubber stamp, it's right.
Let
me clarify for a moment.
Let
me clarify that, in fact, the proposed regulations do not use the RP 2014 mortality table.
They
reacted. There was a process. You talked about notice and comment. In 2015, we issued a notice soliciting comments, not on in general on what studies are out there, et cetera.
It was 13. It was not 15.
Well, we did it in 13 and 15, I believe.
We got no response that there's any other tables besides.
We wrote you repeatedly on this topic.
That there was no other tables besides
absolutely.
The one
we
the society.
Suggested other tables. We actually absolutely did. I actually, in my folder, I have letters we gave you on other tables, and I will go get them and show them to you, the letters, and you were copied on them. So that's not true.
I would like to see the letters again.
I printed them out.
That's fine. My recollection is the primary comments about the appropriateness of that table had to do with how the society moved the actual data from the study, which centered around 2006, was the years 2004 to 2008, centered in 2006, forward from 2006 to 2014. There were a lot of concerns raised. We reacted to those concerns, and in fact, our proposed regulation does not use the society procedure that they used in the RP 2014 study to go from 2006 to 2014. It does, in fact, take into account updated data that the society had not used.
And I agree with you that that was one of the key points, that in fact, probably the central point of the letters, was the projection forward from 2006 to 2014. But it was not the only point that was contained in the series of letters. There were a number of other points expressing concern that were not responded to.
Certainly there are concern, the continued comments been of concern about the long-term projection. We're certainly aware of that.
Right, yes, and that's one of them, but it wasn't all. It was also the base table concerns, absolutely. Am I back on the clock? This is kind of fun, but all right. Okay, where the heck am I? All right, well, I think we have talked about most of the things. I think the only thing that I would say, sort of wrapping up this section, is, you know, under the 2-for-1, obviously there would need to be two regs repealed with a net incremental cost of zero. And under the most recent iteration of the guidance, under Executive Order 13771, every effort should be made to use the cost savings for those other regs should benefit the defined benefit plan sponsors, not sort of other industries. In other words, the idea shouldn't be cost on Party A, benefit to Party B. The rules say that every effort should be made that if it's a cost imposed on A, the benefits of the cost savings should go to A.
So let me just make sure I understand. To the extent you're now saying you have a baseline, so there's a benefit because of you're looking at 1996 data and how it's changed mortality for the current period, and all that cost should then go back to DB plans as opposed to other entities or taxpayers.
Are we supposed to find other legislative regulations that we can modify?
If we get to that point, I would be thrilled, and I would absolutely identify two regulations for you to modify. I would love the opportunity to do that if we're in that stage of the process. And yes, the answer to your question, Vicki, is yes. Back on the clock. All right. Well, all right. So I know you're going to be crushed, but I'm going to move on to a different topic. And that is effective date. We strongly believe that there needs to be an 18-month period between the publication of the final regulation and the effective date. And we believe it for sort of two reasons primarily. I mean, this is going to have an effect of hundreds of millions of dollars on some companies. And to expect people in a few months to sort of change their business plans, you know, based on sort of new hundreds of millions of dollars sort of liability is not realistic. People need time. I mean, the argument I've heard is, well, you know, what about sort of, you know, they could just look at the proposed reg. Well, that just means, hey, forget notice and comment. You should just sort of accept the proposed reg. There's got to be a notice and comment, and after it's finalized, they need a significant amount of time to plan for a huge new liability. I think the second point is this simply doesn't work. The 2018 doesn't work at all with respect to the partial credibility tables. In other words, you're now saying we'll publish regs at some point, then someone's got to study those partial credibility regs. They've got to prepare a study over several months. They send it to the IRS, which looks at it for a few months. Then there's back and forth for a few months. By the time, if we finalize today, you know when they get that back? We probably get it back in March of 2018. This has to be done. These partial credibility tables need to be approved months and months and months in advance, not after the fact. So to have a 1/1/18 is simply making this unworkable and throwing people into into a place where they cannot plan ahead. And that's not appropriate. Now, Linda mentioned earlier, and I wanted to come back to it. Well, wait a second. You're under statutory requirement to do this every 10 years. But let's be really clear about this. That is a statutory requirement that only is applicable, and I know you're going to protest, but I'm going to come back and explain why I disagree with your protest. So I should be off the clock, but
we'll give you time off the clock.
Okay. So, but the notion here is that if this was, for example, January of 2019, there is no one in this room who would contend this should be effective 1/1/18 because of the 10-year rule. So in other words, because it would be totally unworkable, and what I'm saying, it's totally unworkable right now to make this 1/1/18. And to illustrate how the Treasury and the service have already come to that conclusion in other situations, countless other situations, including one in this very reg. The partial credibility rules, by statute, are effective 1/1/16. Not 17, not 18, not 19, 1/1/16. And that statutory deadline was simply disregarded. So this notion that something is sort of inviolate about sort of a statutory deadline for when you have to put the regs into effect, it's inconsistent with your own regulation. What your own regulation stands for is the proposition that you need to have a reasonable period ahead of time to make this before this thing can become effective. You've reflected that in the way you've approached partial credibility. There's no reason to take a different position on the base table.
Kent,
my last two topics.
Just a note.
Almost got through that.
Was the organization you're representing sent a letter in July of 2015 saying you needed more time? I mean, the 2014 society study was out there. People have been using the society projections for audited financial statements since 2014. Why does it need more time?
Well, that's absolutely not right. And that's absolutely not right in the sense that under accounting principles, they've had the ability all along to show a different sort of set of materials. So that there's nothing mandatory about those standards for accounting purposes. So this notion of, well, gee, they've been in effect and everybody's been tickled with them, that's not true.
I didn't say they've been tickled with them.
But they're not.
They've been using them.
Not a huge amount are not using them. In other words, that is not sort of the across the board. I mean, they're sort of a whole industry sort of saying, yes, we can make a reasonable showing to our actors, to our, in fact, some of the, I heard that some of the auditors were saying initially that if you actually used it, it was sort of inappropriately tough and when the original 2014 came into place. So that, the fact that the argument that, gee, everyone's used to this, everyone's using it, that's not true. I mean, for accounting purposes, it's not mandatory for accounting purposes, and many people don't use it for accounting purposes.
So you're you're more concerned about the budgetary purpose because of the cash contribution instead of the software issue of implementing this two-dimensional projection scale. Is that?
In part because the input as a plan sponsor organization, the input that we received was focused primarily on sort of the effect on the plan sponsor and the plan sponsor liability. I don't want to discount by any means the sort of software transition. I'm not sure that would require 18 months, though. So the 18 months came, and we were originally at 12 months. And as Harlan would tell me if he'd sort of, we've written before on 12 months. But we got a very strong set of input from plan sponsors saying, on the liability side, 12 is not enough. We need much more planning than that. So that was something which we were surprised about and by the passion with which plan sponsors felt. So I am not sort of arguing for 18 based on the software issues. I would yield to my sort of learned colleagues coming up sort of on that, but I'm not sure at all that we would need 18 for the software issues. But that's not my area of expertise. Two relatively quick final thing, so I'm actually going to be under time, I think. One is, I think, and I'm going to say something nice, which is, and that is, I think the community's reaction to the process for creating substitute mortality tables, the simplified process, was very favorable. People liked it. But it did beg the question of, why not have an automatic approval process? If it's so simplified, you know, what's going to happen? Are we going to send this over and it's going to sit around for 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 months, in which case this is a disaster? Or is it going to come back instantly? And if it's going to come back instantly, why the heck didn't we just do an automatic approval process? That's what this cries out for, because of how well you did in terms of simplifying the process. And lastly, we were disappointed that existing substitute mortality tables were not grandfathered. In other words, suppose I did my study 2 years ago, I submitted it, I've got my full credibility substitute mortality table, I've got to throw that out and start over? That just seems like unnecessary. They should be grandfathered, they submitted their data, they should be grandfathered under the old system. And with 50 seconds or something, I'm done.
No, you're over by
then. Our alert system had a malfunction I've now fixed.
Well, I tend to have that effect on people.
Do people have any other questions?
One last question I have is, when you talk about the 18 months delay, you mentioned that the people would now go to do the experience study. Like, it's with a partial credibility, there's not enough time. I'm not quite sure I understand, because it actually simplifies the calculation of the mortality table, but the experience study itself should be the same. So I'm not sure why you need extra time to
And I apologize because I don't fully understand, but so let me just try and understand. We talked through this. I mean, what I'm saying is, okay, I've got this plan with 50,000 participants, okay? Too small to use full credibility. So right now, they look at their experience and they think, well, it's much better than this new table that's being proposed. So once this new table and the partial credibility rules get finalized, then they can go and sort of hire someone to do an experience study. And to do an experience study sort of that would sort of meet your criteria. That will take a few months. Submit it to you guys. You guys look at it for a few months. And then maybe there's back and forth. That whole process, you know, 7, 8, 10 months. And if you started now, you're already past 2018. So I don't even know what my mortality sort of table is until after the beginning of the year. That's pretty bad for planning. That's my position.
Yeah. Okay.
Go ahead.
I think. Go ahead.
Okay. Do you have any data about the number of plan sponsors you expect to request substitute tables under the new regulations?
No, I don't. You know, I guess I would. I don't want to keep putting pressure on my two smarter colleagues coming up, but you know. They would have a better feel than I do.
Do the panelists have any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next, Michael Pollack from Willis Towers Watson.
Geez, that's a tough act to follow. Good morning. I'm Michael Pollack of Willis Towers Watson. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to express our views regarding the proposed changes to the defined benefit plan mortality regulations. Before getting into specific suggestions, we would like to commend the IRS for balancing the many competing objectives that went into this and for modifying the regulations to reflect more up-to-date mortality tables and enabling the use of partial credibility. Overall, we think it was a very generally reasonable proposal. That being said, we do have some suggestions. The first issue I want to talk about is something that Kent did get into, and that's mortality improvement. You know, we believe that it's the responsibility of the IRS and Treasury on an ongoing basis to select appropriate mortality assumptions, including the improvement assumptions, to be used across the whole defined benefit system. And in fulfilling this responsibility, we think that you should not be overly reliant on any particular view or any source of information. And we're concerned that the regulations suggest that the plan really is to just simply adopt the Society of Actuaries improvement skills as they're published each year. I know it doesn't explicitly say that, but you know, I think our reader could infer that. An assumption about regarding the future mortality improvement rate, if any, is fundamentally not an actuarial assumption or not an actuarial issue. It's highly speculative, as Kent talked about. Historically, it's been quite volatile, and a wide range of views exist on the issue, and all of them tend to have logical arguments to support them that could neither be proven or disproven. Our particular view is that the SOA's 1% assumption about ultimate improvement is too high. Since the publication of the 2014 study, improvement rates have consistently been well below what was assumed in that study, resulting in the Society issuing MP 2015 and 16, both of which had lower improvement rates, but in issuing those new scales, they maintained the 1% assumption long term. While we disagree with the 1% assumption, we're not here to assert that our view is right or that the Society's view is wrong, because only time will tell what the ultimate rate is going to be. But our point is that there's a variety of reasonable views that exist, such as that of Social Security, and IRS and Treasury shouldn't be overly reliant on one view and shouldn't automatically defer to what the SOA says on the issue. In addition, we think...
I read your letter on that. I wasn't clear on exactly what the recommendation was, aside from don't automatically defer to SOA, and you know, and we've you know explicitly not committed to following that in the proposed regulations. Do you have a recommendation on what we should be doing for the ultimate assumption?
Well, I think the main point really is don't just defer. You know, it's your responsibility to make a thoughtful decision each year. And you know, again, we're not saying the SOA is wrong. I don't know. You know, my crystal ball is not any better than anybody else's. I mean, there's a large body of, you know, research, and but fundamentally, I mean, the Society's approach was a very mathematical approach in building models, and, you know, human mortality doesn't necessarily follow models. So
but
there's not a...
Just to explore, you're not saying you think it should be zero. You think 1% is too high and that there are other views there, but you're
yes.
not advocating it be zero.
Yes. I mean, I'll tell you my personal view, not necessarily my firm's. I don't think zero is an unreasonable assumption. I think you say that to some people and they think you're crazy. They don't consider that reasonable. I think there's a lot of arguments that could support zero, but I'm not saying that's the right assumption. I don't think there is a right assumption. But I think that's within a reasonable range. And again, that's me personally, as opposed to my firm. So we think the IRS and Treasury should also consider the effects of the assumption on the system as a whole. Overly conservative assumptions would result in higher contributions than necessary, as Kent talked about, higher lump sums in traditional plans than warranted, particularly for younger individuals, and lower annuities from hybrid plans than warranted. And in our view, none of these would be good for the system as a whole. We also believe that changing the improvement scale every year introduces an element of randomness into the process. As improvement rates are going to vary, they're going to go up and down year by year. I mean, just history has shown that. And that randomness could frustrate plan sponsors in their planning efforts and, to a lesser extent, plan participants in their expectations for benefit amounts. So we don't think that's good for the system as well. And we suggest the IRS consider an approach whereby there's no change to the improvement scale unless and until, you know, the current table or the, you know, your current view varies by more than a certain amount from what the current table in use is. You know, we understand that could be a little bit difficult to measure, to boil things down to a single rate and to execute on, but we think it's at least worth considering. It's kind of you're looking
we think you should look for the middle ground. You don't want to wait, you know, 10 or 15 years and have a dramatic change that causes the billions of dollars of, you know, contributions that Kent talks about. But on the other hand, you know, having little wiggles and waggles every year is not necessarily the best thing either.
If we were to follow that, what kind of percentage would you recommend?
You know, I haven't given that a lot of specific thought. I mean, I think the measure, you'd look at the central, probably the central, you know, age-adjusted central death rate.
But on the flip side, if that the impact, if the change is not much, then the impact on liability will not be much either. So
yes,
even that we just publish new rates, you know, you could just, it won't harm, do any harm.
Yeah, I think the you know Chen's point is that you know the whole point of doing it this way is to avoid the cliffiness that
right.
we previously had by not reflecting changes in mortality improvement, and you know there's a tension between you know the stability that you're recommending by you know keeping a set of mortality improvement rates for a few years before changing, and then. Yeah, then that gets cliffier because.
Yeah, absolutely, and
back to the cliffiness.
In the comments we sent in 2005, you know, we did support more frequent adjustments. It just every year might be a little bit too much. I mean, if you step back from it actuarially and you say, you know, does one more year of data really alter what my you know quote best estimate of improvements are? It's the next issue I want to talk.
Can I interrupt you for a moment? The changes flow through to the lump sum mortality, lump sum tables under 417E. So are you suggesting that those not change from year to year? Are you suggesting that we keep just the mortality improvement scale constant, but in fact the static mortality tables that are used for lump sums would still vary from year to year?
No, I'd have them flow through. I'd have consistency.
So you're saying that the lump sum factors would not change from year to year?
Yeah.
Even though you have potentially even more dramatic shifts based on interest rate shifts and lump sum factors, you would keep this piece of it, the mortality, flat?
Yes. I understand interest rates can have a much more dramatic effect. So the next thing I wanted to talk about was transition. You know, as Kent talked about, some plan sponsors sought and obtained approval to use substitute tables under the current regulations. There weren't a large number of such sponsors, but they tended to be quite large. And you know, the effort and cost required to do the study and obtain approval was significant. The tables that they obtained approval for were based on substantial amounts of data that were and remain relevant to the mortality experience of their plans, and they underwent a rigorous review by the IRS and Treasury. The issuance of new standard tables for DB plans doesn't affect the validity and the relevance of those studies, and these studies were and it shouldn't affect the appropriateness of the continued use of those studies, which were approved for a period of years. So we believe that the existing approvals, Kent used the word grandfathering, that they should remain in place as they were approved. Requiring that sponsors discard all the work that they performed and essentially revoking what was a long-term approval seems unfair and could frustrate those sponsors and perhaps diminish their commitment to the DB system. At a minimum, we think that these sponsors should be refunded some or all of their filing fees or be given credit to them towards an application under the new rules once they're finalized and permitted to use the same data and experience study period from their previously approved submissions to minimize the amount of revisions and duplication that they have to do. Another transition element, we suggest that the experience period requirements be relaxed a little bit for the initial applications. Due to the timing of the release of the RP 2014 study,
many plan sponsors perform mortality studies with an experience study period that ended in 2013 or 2014. And these periods would not seem to meet the requirements in the proposal, but we recommend that the proposal be modified to accommodate these periods in situations where the plan population hasn't changed substantially. We don't believe that the additional cost and effort required to add an additional year or two of data and redo a study is warranted. In fact, we'd support a change to a more flexible experience study period more broadly to allow sponsors to better coordinate and leverage studies for various purposes they might need them for. Next issue is automatic approval. Before the proposed regs, we thought that there should be an automatic approval process, and we had one of our colleagues participate in a group with some others from the industry that made a proposal. After reviewing the proposed regulations, they're really very prescriptive in certain areas, so we think automatic approval should be more broadly available. There's flexibility in terms of grouping and subdividing populations, and there's flexibility in the experience period and the length of time you use a study for, but there's really no flexibility in the actual determination of the rates themselves. So we feel like, if there's none of that grouping and the criteria, for the experience period are met, there simply should be automatic approval. And if the IRS wants to put more restrictive requirements on, the study period or the, the distance between the study period and the use date or the length of time that you could use the table for, that, to qualify for automatic approval, that would seem reasonable. But the actual process of the calculations, there's not much flexibility in there, so we're not sure, what the review would really consist of. I mean, people can do the math right. The last issue we wanted to talk about was the requirement that all credible populations within a control group use a substitute table if any population does. We understand the reasoning for this requirement and we agree with it, but we question its practicality and are concerned that it's going to serve to really diminish the use of substitute tables and the better measurements that would result by it. In our experience, there are a lot of large and complex control groups with multiple plans where there's little coordination among the members of the control group on pension issues. So we suggest that the intent of the requirement could be met almost as effectively by applying the rule on an employer level or a plan sponsor level rather than a control group level. And by doing this, we think you'd make the use of substitute tables more feasible to a larger number of plans, and that would benefit the system overall.
Controlled group rule is statutory. Is there some, Amy, do you see some way we can get around that?
I'll have to look. I can get back to you on that. Okay. The last thing is just on the technical aspects, and it's not really a comment, but approval. The comments I've made have been on the process around the tables as opposed to the mechanics of the calculations. There are some elements we might have done differently. We might have permitted graduation, for example, as opposed to requiring a factor and to be used versus the base table. But by and large, we think the approach to the calculations was reasonable and sound and practical and simplified. And hence the arguments for automatic approval. So we wouldn't suggest changes to the mechanics of the calculations. And that concludes my testimony. Thank you very much for the opportunity, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Mike, you referred to grandfathering of existing tables. To what extent does that run into the problem of other plans by, in your case, if you say the plan sponsor rather, or the control group as the case may be, which did not have full credibility, so were permitted not to have their plan specific mortality under the old standards, but which will have partial credibility and thereby would need to use plan specific mortality under the new rules? Do you think that creates an impediment to grandfathering existing approvals for plan-specific mortality?
I think that
the requirement in that situation wouldn't apply if you grandfathered those. They used the tables under a procedure that didn't not only permit but didn't allow it for the other groups. So I think that the rest of the group would have their own independent decision.
So if that kind of approach would possibly frustrate the if one plan uses it, they all use it policy, which you said you understand why Congress put it in place.
But at the time that the initial approval was granted, that wasn't an issue. I mean, they were under the rules. They didn't have other fully credible populations. They couldn't do it. So they didn't, I mean, they did what they could do under the current rules.
And under the grandfathering, would they still switch to the new mortality improvement scale, or would they keep the old scale too?
I think the old scale would be acceptable. I mean, that's what they filed an application for a period of years, and they were approved for, it was approved for its use. I mean, there still are the standards, the requirements about it still representing, an accurate estimate or, of the population. So to the extent that, in light of different scales or up-to-date tables, it was felt that they no longer represented that, then they would have to change. But
do our panelists have any other questions? Thank you very much for your comments. Next, we have Bruce Candenhead from ERIC. Welcome.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Bruce Candenhead. My employer is Mercer, but I'm here representing ERIC today. We both submitted letters. Some people have noticed some similarities between the two, but the views I'm expressing here are, this is on behalf of ERIC. ERIC is the only national association that advocates exclusively for large employers on health, retirement, and compensation public policies at the federal, state, and local levels. ERIC's members provide comprehensive retirement benefits to tens of millions of active and retired workers and their families. Thank you for the opportunity to present my views here, or ERIC's views here. First, I just want to commend on the proposed approach for developing the standard tables. I know that there's a lot of different options, and I'm staying away from the procedural issues, but given the differing views, I think the approach chosen represents probably the one around which at least the most consensus has evolved. There are certainly differing views, especially around the level of future mortality improvement. Again, the MP 2016 scale, I think, moves well in the direction addressing some of the concerns that were originally related to the MP 2014, so glad to see that the latest guidance, the latest release from the SOA was reflected in the proposed guidance. Also support the choice to continue offering static option to all employers, and the approach to developing that static option I think was very cleverly chosen to balance a number of competing objectives, so kudos on that. Does a very nice job of replicating the generational immediate annuity factors across a range of ages and interest rates. I think it's particularly important to maintain the static option as the applicable mortality table for purposes of 417E3. And although this was not addressed in the proposed regulations, and it's not going to be part of the final regulations based on past practice and comments and language in the preamble, we anticipate it's going to continue to be the 50-50 blend of the static combined tables, which I think is an appropriate choice. One concern that we had with regard to the standard tables had to do with the potential timing of updates. After the adoption of PPA, the IRS was able to publish mortality tables for multiple years at once, and this made it easy to do contribution budgeting and provide reasonable benefit estimates well in advance. And I would note to the comment earlier about changes in interest rates, sometimes making it hard to predict. There are a number of plans out there that, for other purposes of other conversions, use 417E mortality tables, and having those available well in advance allows greater certainty around different benefit options. The SOA is now expected to provide updates to mortality projection scales annually, with late October being the likely timing, which raises two potential concerns. One is frequent updates to assumptions that cannot be easily estimated in advance, and the possibility that those updates could be made effective with little advance warning, although we don't expect that it would be the case. Table comes out in October, there's the possibility it could be imposed for the year immediately following, which, based on the current proposal, we would expect and hope for at least a year of advance warning, so that the MP 2017 table released on October 2017 would not be made effective in 2018, but instead would at the very earliest be made effective 2019. Our letter includes suggested language that could be added to the regulations that would commit to that timing. Further, I note that the RPEC has adjusted its methodology somewhat since the MP 2014 scale was first released, in part due to concerns about year-over-year volatility in results as projection scales are updated. The MP 2016 scale, which is quite a bit different from MP 2014, reflects 5 additional years of data as well as somewhat more stable methodology. So we anticipate that future updates to the projection scale are likely to result in a much smaller changes to projected mortality rates and present values year over year, and therefore suggests that the IRS need not wait for every update to the projection scale, but could instead prescribe the use of the most recent or a recent scale for multiple years under the expectation that you wouldn't see large changes, and then could evaluate every couple of years instead of every single year. And that's what I have to say on the standard tables. Switching to the topic of plan-specific mortality adjustment, the proposed approach of developing a single credibility-adjusted mortality ratio is a welcome simplification to the current process. Extending the availability of this option to plans with as few as 100 deaths over the study period is also welcome. However, I do have a few concerns about the proposed approach. One is that the number of deaths required for full credibility is now potentially quite a bit higher, depending on plan demographics, than the current approach, which dilutes the effect of plan experience. To address that, I'm going to propose a number of different ways of combining experience to achieve a higher level of credibility. One is that plans be permitted to aggregate male and female experience in developing a single mortality ratio for the plan as a whole. Making a single adjustment to a standard table is already a simplification in that it assumes that the single adjustment is appropriate across different population subgroups, salaried hourly, for example, and across different age groups, despite the fact that these subgroups will exhibit different rates of mortality relative to the standard table. The proposed approach produces, nevertheless, reasonable results when measured in terms of the effect on overall liability, because those factors tend to cancel out when the focus is simply on the liability measure and not the particular year's mortality rate. So we think that similarly reasonable results could be derived from a single ratio applicable to both the male and female standard tables. The premise behind making a plan-wide adjustment to a standard table is that plan participants share certain characteristics that make it reasonable to presume that they exhibit consistently higher or lower mortality relative to the standard population experience. And these characteristics are likely to apply to both genders, just as they are to other subgroups within the population. Permitting the aggregation of male and female experience would increase the overall credibility assigned to plan experience. And should there be any concern about the validity of this assertion, a secondary test could be imposed to assume that at least the experience for both genders is directionally similar. That is, the mortality ratio separately generated both higher than one or both less than one as appropriate. Similarly, we believe it would be appropriate to allow similar employers to group experience in order to achieve a higher level of credibility. Again, secondary tests could be applied to ensure that employers included in the grouping have directionally similar experience, that they're in a similar industry, and so that there's reason to believe that they would have similarities. And this, although perhaps employers that are too small to have even partially credible experience on their own might be exempted from that secondary test. Also suggest that plans be allowed to request to approval to use blue and white collar tables based on workforce characteristics. If such a demonstration can be made to the satisfaction of the service, then collar-based tables could be used in place of the standard table, or at least as the table to which the credibility adjustment is applied. There are also a number of large multiple employer plans that might have partially credible experience when looking at the plan as a whole, and where no single employer represents a majority of the plan. It appears in reading the regs, although not entirely clear, that as drafted, they could take advantage of what's in the proposed regs, but it would be helpful if this was clarified. Also, the requirement that all employers within the control group, all plans within the control group, look to see if they have partially credible experience and reflect that could be a little bit more problematic when applied to this type of a situation. It would be difficult for the multiple employer plan in question to impose such a requirement on its members, or even to verify that such analysis has been done. Therefore, suggest that multiple employer plans where no single employer constitutes the majority of the plan be exempt from any requirement to do a similar study for other plans maintained by its members, or by the control groups of its members. Finally, point out a potential problem with the transition period for newly affiliated plans. It appears, and I read this a bunch of times and I'm not quite sure, but it appears that from our reading that a plan acquired mid-year would have to gather data for the period ending 1 year after the acquisition, and if that data is partially credible, then apply to reflect that experience for the immediately following plan year, and in some situations the experience period would end after the application deadline. And this may be a misreading, in which case we just request that the regulations be clarified, but otherwise suggest that the regulations be modified to allow for a reasonable period of time to gather data for newly affiliated plans. And that is the end of my remarks. Made it just in time?
What? Did panels?
Bruce, I have a couple questions for you. On the multiple employer plan suggestion, the idea that there is no employer who represents a majority, is that what you, is any particular reasoning for that particular line, as opposed to, for instance, there's a line that's been drawn in the 10 or more employer plans under 419 AF6 that's no more than 10%. Sort of corresponding to 10 or more employers. Do you have a sense of the utility of having, whether you're looking for a really broad-based multiple employer rule or you're looking for a narrower multiple employer
rule? Right. Well, I think I'd say there's two really distinct types of multiple employer plans. There's one where there's a large employer and then a joint venture is kind of tacked on and a small employer. So we're not talking about those situations, but where there's really a plan that covers a large number of employers and where there may not be any or there may only be one substantial employer that meets the 10% test that you reference. And so really to make this workable, I think if you imposed a requirement just on the substantial employers and not all of the other employers, that would go a long way towards making it easy to do, because the substantial employers usually at least are involved in the ongoing running of the plan, and you would be able to kind of work with them to make sure that if they participated in any other plans, that the plans went through the necessary analysis. But extending it to all of the employers, where you could have situations where you've got an employer that's just in for a few of their employees, but they also participate in some larger plan, that's what I see as the more problematic situation.
Okay, the other question, you referred to aggregating male and female lives for purposes of getting the mortality ratio and getting the experience. My understanding is that that isn't standard actuarial practice to do a mortality study that combines disparate expected mortalities.
Can you cite to, I recognize the fact that we don't require people to split out an hourly and a salaried, but can you cite to something which actuarially shows it's reasonable to put together things which you know are inherently of different mortality experience?
So, first of all, I wouldn't say that it would be reasonable if you were coming up with population-wide tables, which is not what we're talking about here, or if you were asking an employer to come up with their own tables, as was the case under the current regulations. What we're talking about here is an adjustment to a standard table. And in this case, the way I see it is it's more a matter of how you define the standard table. Is it separate standard male and female tables, or are the male and females together the standard table? As far as analysis around this, I'm not aware of any specific studies. In preparing comments and working with a number of groups to try to assess whether or not this is reasonable, I did look at a few things. I did some analysis myself to say, well, what if, for example, you had a population that exhibited the same underlying mortality, let's say say it was a blue collar, followed the blue collar tables, right? The adjustment relative to the standard no collar table for male and female is not exactly the same. I think it's a little bit more of an adjustment for males than for females, but they both move in the same direction. So the test that I did is, if you looked at that separately and made a separate adjustment versus aggregating together and making a single adjustment and measuring the liabilities, how much of an effect would it have? And I don't have the exact numbers in front of me, but the results were pretty close in terms of the overall effect on liabilities. And if that enables you to take, say, a population that has half credible, or has half enough deaths to be credible for males and half for females, and put them together and allows it to be fully credible, then I think that gets you closer to, on an overall basis, a reasonable outcome.
And so is that based on the assumption that males and females are equally distributed among the, among job classifications?
I think that's not even necessarily a premise of the current approach, because when you're aggregating experience, say, within a gender, you've got multiple job classifications, you've got multiple ages, and the different ages could still exhibit different relative mortality to the baseline, and you would expect that would in fact be the case. So I'm really arguing more in terms of the overall effect. If you aggregate the male and female and apply a single ratio developed on that basis, it will be weighted by the number of participants who are blue collar, who are white collar, who are different ages, who are male, who are female, and by their benefits, so that you get an appropriate adjustment kind of reflecting the characteristics of the workforce.
Let me make sure that I'm following. Are you determining the mortality ratio by comparison to the gender separate tables, but you're just raising the credibility factor? Is that what you're, or are you comparing a mortality ratio to some kind of blended table in the first place?
There's two ways that you could look at it. One is to just increase the credibility and apply then separate ratios to male and female. But the way that I looked at it was to do the analysis with the male and female experience together. So when you do that calculation, you are looking at...
By reference to what?
By reference to the separate male and female tables. So in other words, you are coming up with an age, a benefit-weighted number of deaths, and you are not applying that to a single assumption, a single Q at a single age, but rather to all of the different ages for male participants. You're doing the same thing for female participants. All I'm saying is, instead of separately coming up with the ratio, add those results together in developing the ratio that is then applied, same ratio, to the male and to the female tables. Mathematically, the analysis works just the same, whether you, at least in terms of being able to apply it, if you apply it separately to male and female, or if you calculate the results on male and female basis and then add it up and come up with the single ratio.
You're saying the expected deaths would be based on separate genders?
That's right. The expected deaths under the standard table would still be based on the separate gender tables. Yes. And would be based on, you know, each participant's age. So you would take the data that you know about that participant, age and gender, apply the standard mortality rate, come up with the expected benefit-weighted deaths, do the same thing for females, and combine the results.
I have a question on the industry-wide mortality table. So are you, I mean, for if certain industry wants to create a table, is that employer will, can participate voluntarily? Like, how does this going to work out?
So I think practically, to address the concerns about having the table relate to the experience of the employers who were using it, you would probably want to have some requirement that that the study was based on the employers using it, as opposed to being, you know, anybody could use a table based on someone else's experience. But it would be instead of having the employers come in on their own, if they can demonstrate that they have, you know, a common industry, and that the argument is that their employees are likely to be facing the same kind of effects, that they could come in together and pool their experience and come up with a table that allows for a greater degree of overall credibility.
Okay.
And again, you might want to look to see, all right, are they all trending in the same direction? You don't want to have one employer, you know, way over here offsetting the experience of another employer.
There will be, say, 10 companies or 10 pension plans in that industry. Five will come together, create a table. The other five could just use the standard table. Is that?
I think if you were part of this, and you were found to be a reasonable part of the group, then everybody who's part of that group would, I would expect you would want them to all use it or all not to use it at the same time. Now, that might raise transition issues. What if one of the employers acquires another group? You'd probably want to allow a reasonable period of time so that it doesn't throw all of the employers out of being able to do that kind of, to continue to use the table unpredictably.
Questions? Thank you very much. Is there anyone who hasn't spoken who would like to speak? This ends the public hearing on proposed regulations. Thank you very much for coming, for your thoughtful comments and your responses to questions. The hearing is on mortality tables for determining present value under defined benefit pension plans, Reg 11232415. Thanks again.